Just look at this mess. I mean, what a mess. Now, I'm not talking about the fellowship hall or the sanctuary. That's actually looking pretty clean these days. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
I'm talking about my life. My life is a mess. I've got brokenness in my heart, in my soul, in my mind. There's some messiness there. Good thing I've got all the right tools that I need to clean up that mess. I've got my drill here so I can drill away my fears. Oh, wait, man, that's not working. Okay, I've got my hedge trimmers up here so I can trim down my anxieties, my hurts. Good thing I got my radio up here, because if I got to do all this work, at least I can pump some jams while I'm doing it. Some old Wesley classics, I suppose, or something, right? That's not working either. Hold on a second. Alright, now I know my trusted table saw is going to work, because I got to cut away the messiness of my life. No, you know what? Let me try something. Oh, yeah. Wasn't plugged in. Oh, don't you hate when that happens? Alright, let's see what we got. A lot of work to do. Now I'm ready to get to work. You know, the kids in New Life had a lot cooler reaction to that. You know, all of us have some messiness in our life. Can I get an amen? All of us have some brokenness. You know, it's funny, we go through life a lot like this dilemma. Maybe we're plugged into the right power source, but we don't have the right tools to clean up the brokenness of our life. Or maybe we've got all the tools, but we're not plugged into the power source. A lot of people go through life like this extension cord, not plugged in and not serving their intended purpose. You know, there's a lot of things you can do with an extension cord besides its intended purpose. You can use an extension cord to play tug of war. You can use an extension cord to tie it around the back of your golf cart and pull your kids around in the field. That's what we do at the Beck household. You can use an extension cord to tie up your children when they're disobedient. I've done it, I know. I'm just kidding, I've never actually done that. But the intended purpose of an extension cord is to plug into a power source and to convey that energy, that power to the place, the location where we need it, so we can use the tools to do the job. An extension cord that's not plugged in, not conveying energy, is not really doing anything. And just by the fact that we live in a world that is very, very good, called by God good, but currently broken and marred with the reality of sin, means that we're going to have some messiness in our life. We're going to have some brokenness in our life. Can I get an amen? But the good news of the gospel is that it is not God's desire that we live in a broken state. Amen. It is not God's desire that we live with a fractured relationship with God and with each other. It's not God's desire that we walk around with messiness in our hearts and our souls and our minds. But it is His desire to heal us, to cure us, to give us a life that is fully life. Where do you go when you're broken? How do you plug in to the power source? What are the tools God has given us to clean up the messiness of sin in our lives and the world? Where do you go when you're broken? Who do you turn to when you're hurting? Grab your Bibles. We're going to need them. Let's pray over the Word of God. Heavenly Father, we thank You for Your Word. It is a light unto our path. It is a mirror that shows us who we are. It's a revelation, O God, that shows us who You are. And so we pray that this would not be simply time of just another church service, but we come humbly seeking an encounter with You, Lord Jesus. We pray that You would cause these words to burst forth from their meek cage and live and dance in us in an incarnate way. And we ask the Holy Spirit that You would unleash the power of Your Word in this place. And that You would give us the strength to not simply be hearers of the Word only, but doers also. It's in the mighty name of Jesus we pray, and all God's people said,
Amen.
How many of you have ever been sick? Anybody ever had a cold in your life? You know, that miserable state, runny nose, headache, coughing. Where do you go if you have a cold? The doctor, the physician, get a pill, right? Our kids in New Life said they go to mama. That's pretty accurate. Get that chicken noodle soup and some bed rest, right? Any of you ever had a disease in your life? Where do you go when you got a disease? The doctor, the physician, get some medication, right? A surgical correction. Where do you go when you have mental disease? Pain, affliction, depression. We go to a psychiatrist, we go take a pill, we go to get some counseling, right? And all those vocations and all those tools are from God. They are good. God has given us brains to use and figure these things out and how to do things with the body, surgery and medications. But in our text this morning, in the context of the Sermon on the Mount, those are resources and tools that this population of people that come to Jesus don't have. You know, we can largely overlook the fact that 9 out of 10 people in the ancient world usually died of things that today we can just take a shot or a pill or go see a doctor. Now, there was a rudimentary form of medical practice. It wasn't very effective, and it was usually reserved for those that were wealthy or affluent. There's even kind of a primitive form of counseling back in Jesus' day, but it was mostly reserved for the Caesars or those who had extravagant wealth, and again, not very effective. But we see in the context of the Sermon on the Mount, where sometimes we just jump into the sermon without understanding the context, who's coming to hear the sermon? What's the situation in which Jesus is proclaiming this sermon? And Matthew's very clear with us that there are large masses of people whose lives are a mess. They are broken. They are stricken with the realities of sin and disease and sickness. And so Jesus goes throughout the area of Galilee. And what does Jesus do? Well, he does primarily 3 things. Number one, he is teaching in their synagogues. Jesus is a good teacher. Can I get an amen? He's going around like itinerant rabbis do and teaching in the synagogues, maybe more familiar to us, like a good United Methodist itinerant preacher. He's going around place to place. But not only is he teaching, in Matthew, one of his emphases is he really wants us to know that Jesus is the teacher, but he's also proclaiming the good news. Jesus is preaching, and Jesus is a good preacher, y'all. Can I get an amen? He's going around and he's proclaiming. What is he proclaiming? He's proclaiming this thing called the euangelion in the Greek. The gospel, the good news. What is the content of this good news, this preaching of Jesus? Well, it's the euangelion, it's the good news of the kingdom. At the centerpiece of Jesus' sermons and his proclamation is this proclamation of a coming kingdom, an imminent kingdom. Mark summarizes Jesus' preaching like this. The kingdom is here. The kingdom is now. Repent and believe the good news. But along with this teaching and this preaching, Jesus is also doing something else. For in Jesus is not just simply the words and the power of the sermon, but in Jesus there is power to cure every disease and every sickness among the people. To cure. Can y'all say that word with me? Cure. And the word there is therapeuo in the Greek, where we get the word therapy or therapeutic process. And so not only is Jesus proclaiming this revolutionary message of a coming kingdom, but he has deeds of power to accompany that proclamation. Where people are sick, where people are diseased, Jesus cures, he heals their sicknesses. Wherever Jesus goes, they can shut down the hospitals and the psych wards and the mental institutions. When Jesus comes to town, you can shut down the emergency room and the psych wards. Because when Jesus comes to town preaching this revolutionary kingdom message, there is power to cure and remedy the problems of sin and brokenness in this world. In the proclamation and the power of Jesus, there is power to turn this upside down world right side up. Can somebody give me an amen this morning? I came to preach. In Jesus is this power to cure their ailments, their sicknesses, their diseases. And so naturally, fame about his name starts to spread throughout the land. Now, not fame in the sense that we think of fame in the North American postmodern context of movie stars and singers and such, but Jesus' name, his reputation, precedes him. His name starts to ring bells all through the ancient world, and people say, here's this one named Jesus, in whom there's a proclamation of a good news of a coming kingdom, and there's power to heal and remedy our sicknesses. And so they brought to him all who were sick. Have you ever been sick in your life? I know some of you. I know you've been sick. Jesus heals their sickness. Thank you, Shannon. I got an amen. Have you ever been afflicted? Jesus cures their affliction. Have you ever been afflicted with various diseases? Jesus heals their various diseases. Those diseases that they had no hope and no tools to ever recover from, Jesus heals them. Have you ever had pain in your life? You know, pain in your heart, pain in your soul, pain in your mind. Maybe just the pain of a body growing old. Anybody ever had any of that? Jesus heals their pains. He heals their demoniacs and those mentally ill. He heals the epileptics who have seizures. He heals the paralytics, those who have mobility issues. He cures them. Therapeuo. He takes away their brokenness, their illness, their disease. Oh, there is power in the name of Jesus to heal. Amen. And so naturally, great crowds follow him from Galilee, the Decapolis, the 10 cities, Jerusalem, Judea, from beyond the Jordan. Who do these crowds consist of? Well, notice who's not in the crowds. Not the affluent and the wealthy. It's not the healthy that need a doctor. It's the sick. Can I give amen? Notice who's not in the crowds. Not the church folks. Not the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the religious elite. Maybe there's a couple of those mixed into these crowds. But they are crowds of sick and diseased and broken people who have no hope and no remedy and no cure for the messiness and the brokenness of their lives. And maybe you could even find yourself in those crowds. Maybe this sermon that Jesus delivers is not really just for those who are there to hear it on that day, for there's a power and a fluidity in the Word of God that cuts to the continuity of our situation today. Maybe you find yourself in the crowds. Maybe you've got some brokenness, some dis-ease. But here's the good news. When Jesus saw the crowds, when Jesus edo, he saw them. Jesus sees us in our brokenness. Jesus sees us in our dis-ease. Jesus sees you. And his desire is to heal, to cure, to mend that brokenness. He saw those crowds, and so he went up to the mountain. Now, one of the things Matthew loves to do is called this Moses typology. So Matthew sees Jesus as a type of Moses, but something far beyond Moses. But, you know, Moses is saved down to Egypt as a baby. Jesus is saved down in Egypt as a baby. Moses goes up to the mountain to give the law. Jesus goes up to the mountain to give this gospel, this good news, to fulfill the law and to correct the inerrancies of the interpretations of the religious folks of the law in his day. So he goes up, he sits down, which is the posture of a teacher. His disciples came to him. Here are these crowds of oppressed, marginalized, broken people. They are tuned in, they are listening, and Jesus starts to preach. And Jesus is a good preacher. Can I get an amen? But more so than Jesus just being a good preacher, more so than that, Jesus is the living Word. See, this is the greatest oral event in the history of the universe, folks. This is the one who John tells us in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. All things were made through him. This is the living Word that spoke with a bang and brought everything into existence. Stars and skies and planets and you and me. This is the living Word now sitting down on top of a mountain and giving us the life-giving words that will transform our lives, that will bring us out of a state of brokenness and into a state of life that is fully life. Somebody give me an amen this morning. Jesus is about to preach, y'all. And like any good preacher, his sermon has 3 points. 3 major sections. So Jesus gives us an introduction. And this introduction is what we call the Beatitudes. They kind of summarize, give us a highlight of everything that's to come. Then Jesus gives us some interpretation. And then finally, in the 7th chapter, he gives us the application of the sermon. What do you do with this? What do you take away with this? Many preachers still follow that format today. And he starts with this series of Beatitudes. Now, the founder of our people called Methodist, this revival movement, John Wesley, he thought this was one of the most essential and important sections of Scripture that we could come to understand in all of the Bible. In fact, John Wesley says of this teaching of Jesus Christ called the Beatitudes that it is the way to heaven. It is the design for living. Amen. It is the order of salvation, which Wesley believed happens in stages of grace, prevenient and justifying and sanctifying grace. This is a way for us simpletons like me that we can see the process of salvation in a very simple process, step by step. So this guy named John Baker comes along a couple hundred years after Wesley, and he's studying the Sermon on the Mount, and he goes, whoa, wait a minute. The 12 steps are right here in Jesus' Beatitudes. Now, if you've never heard of the 12 steps are a tool that God has used in the lives of millions of people to take from a state of brokenness to a state of spiritual awakening. And those 12 steps are really the biblical process of salvation. Right? And so, John Baker discovers that. There's this group called the Oxford Group and a guy named Sam Shoemaker who helped develop these principles right out of the Scriptures. Then there's some guys named Bill W. and Dr. Bob. They come along and they develop these things that we have called the 12 steps. And all those things are born right here in the 8 principles of Jesus' teaching that we call the Sermon on the Mount. And the first beatitude, or the first step, or the first principle, if you will, says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Now, beatitudes should be familiar to us. We saw 7 of them in John's Revelation, right? They were attributed to Jesus. Beatitudes are a popular teaching form, but Jesus doesn't innovate or create beatitudes. They're actually there in the Old Testament. They're used a lot. For instance, Psalm 1 is a beatitude, a statement of blessedness. Blessed is the one who walks not in the counsel of the wicked, or stands in the way of sinners, or sits in the seat of mockers, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And on the word of God they meditate day and night, and they shall be like a tree planted by the river that bears fruit in its season, whose leaf never withers, and everything they do, they'll prosper. Not so for the wicked, for they'll be burned up and blown away like the chaff. That's a beatitude. But Jesus' beatitudes are revolutionary. They are world upturning. They are entirely subversive to the cultural paradigm of wisdom in Jesus' day and to the religious establishment of Jesus' day. For when people hear this, blessed are the poor in spirit, they're automatically thinking, no, they're not. Right? To be blessed, makareo in the Greek, which you can translate as happy, and John Wesley's okay with that, but being blessed is more than being happy. And you could be in a state in your life when all hell is breaking loose and you can still be blessed. Now, happiness and joy is a byproduct of being a blessed person, because you're a kingdom person. You're a person that belongs to the kingdom. You're a person that exhibits these attributes and characteristics that Jesus is looking for in his followers. And if you have these kind of characteristics in your life now, they have echoes in eternity. But the Pharisees, the Sadducees, the religious folks of Jesus' day, they said, no, no, no. Blessed are the healthy, wealthy, and wise. You ever heard that little postmodern prosperity gospel? No, no, people that are rich and healthy and have access to education, and those are the blessed people, because God has blessed us that way. It's the poor and the broken and the downtrodden. Those are cursed of God. The poor in spirit are cursed of God, not blessed. Or as Luke says, simply, blessed are the poor. And everybody's going, wait a minute, blessed are the poor? Don't you have that backwards, Jesus? What is this poverty of spirit? What is this beatitude attitude that Jesus is looking for in his followers? What does it mean to be in a state of poverty of spirit? Well, in one sense, there is a group of thousands, maybe tens of thousands of people gathered in the mountain that day. That's exactly their state. They're in a state of poverty of spirit. To be in poverty of spirit means to realize our deep need for God. It means to acknowledge that we are not God and that our life is unmanageable. It means to acknowledge that we've got this emptiness, that we are powerless, that there's this void in our soul, and we can try to fill that void with all kinds of stuff, can't we? We can try to fill it with money and prestige and accolades and education and family and relationships, people, places, and things. Some people try to fill that void with substances. Some people try to fill that void with church. Hello, didn't think I'd get an amen there. Church can be a coping mechanism that people use all their lives and go to church and never have a relationship with God. You can try to fill that void with all kinds of things, but the only thing that will ever fill the God-shaped hole in our souls is a relationship with God and the power of the Holy Spirit. Somebody give me an amen this morning. You can drink down and take all the money that the world has to offer, and you will still be empty at the end of the day, because we are created to be in relationship with God. We are in a place of poverty of spirit. And that's the first step of salvation, folks. To realize we got a mess to deal with. To realize there's some brokenness in our hearts and our souls and our minds, and only God, only a Savior, can remedy that. You know, I get the opportunity to go and visit people in their homes on a weekly basis, and I get to hear their stories. And I always get to ask them, how did you meet Jesus Christ? How did you become a Christian? You know, the church has done a really good job at building Christians from the ground up. So we baptize them as babies. We start going to church and Sunday school all our lives. I know that some of you hears today's story. And you can be have that gradual kind of relationship and be an upstanding, vibrant follower of Jesus Christ. But there are many, many people who have that experience of going to church all their lives and never know God. Never have a relationship with Jesus, because we never did the step one. That we were broken, that we were powerless, that our life was unmanageable. It's not just that we're good people who made a couple mistakes. Our hearts are continually inclined toward evil. We are broken beyond the ability to pull ourselves up by our own bootstraps and restore ourselves. We need a Savior. We need a Mashiach. We need a Messiah that can lift us up from that brokenness and fill our life with His Spirit and His power and His love. Somebody give me an amen. That's what it means to be poverty of spirit people. Acknowledge I'm not God, but I sure do need Him.
Amen.
And theirs is the kingdom. The second beatitude is, blessed are those that mourn, for they will be comforted. And again, people are gathered there going, well, hey, I'm in on that. You know, here we are gathered together, broken, we're mourners. But again, this is subversive wisdom. What do you mean, blessed are those who are mourned? Is the beatitude attitude that Christ is looking for in us that we walk around a bunch of negative Nellies? You know, I think about mourning. I mourn the loss of a loved one, or I mourn the loss of a job or a divorce. That's mourning, right? And on one level, this is a promise of Jesus saying, those who suffer in this life, those who mourn, you will be comforted. That's a good promise. Can I get into that? But there's something deeper here. What does it mean to really mourn? What is Jesus looking for? What is step two? Well, to mourn is to mourn the state of our sin. It's to mourn the brokenness of our life and how our sin has affected others and how we've hurt others. And that brings us to the state that King David found when he murdered Uriah the Hittite and slept with his wife. And in the 51st Psalm, he mourns out to God, have mercy on me, O God, according to your unfailing love, according to the multitude of your tender mercy, blot out my transgressions, wash away my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin. For my sin is ever before me. Against you only have I sinned and done that which is evil in your sight, so that you are proved right when you speak and justified when you judge. Behold, I was born in sin. My mother was sinful who conceived me, and I too am sinful. Behold, you desire wisdom in the inmost place. Make me to know wisdom in my inmost heart. Purify me with hyssop and I'll be clean. Wash me and I'll be whiter than snow. Let the bones which you have broken rejoice. Wash away my iniquity and cleanse me from my guilt. Create in me a clean heart, O God. In a right, steadfast, immovable spirit, do not hide your face from me or take your Holy Spirit from me, but restore to me the joy of my salvation and uphold me with a willing spirit. Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will turn back to you. Save me from my blood guilt, O God, the God who saves me, and my tongue will sing of your righteousness. Open my lips, and my mouth will show forth your praise. For you delight not in sacrifice, or I would bring it. The sacrifice that's acceptable to God is a broken spirit. A broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise. A heart that is thoroughly penitent with the weight of sin, mourning our sinful condition, O God, that is the gift you desire. See, that's what it means to mourn, folks. It should make us mourn our sinful proclivities. It should make us mourn the damage we've caused and the mess we've caused in the lives of others. It should make us mourn when we look out into the world and we see people trapped in bondage and sin and they don't know Jesus as their Lord. And most of all, it should make us mourn when we think about the sacrifice for our sins. None other than the broken body and poured out blood upon the side of our Savior. And if that doesn't make you mourn, folks, nothing will. But Jesus promises us, if we come to that place of mourning, if we come to that place of reality where we come to believe that He can restore us, that He can recover us, that if we will come to Him and we will yield to Him and we will be honest, that He will comfort us. Where do you go when you're broken? Where do you turn when you're sick? Where do you go when you're in a state of dis-ease? How do we plug in to this power and translate our messy, broken lives into eternal ones? Well, this message that Jesus proclaims that the kingdom has come is inextricably linked to His own person. You see, He is the kingdom. He is God's recovery plan. And as Nicole so powerfully pointed out last week, that all people are in the need of recovery, that all people are in a state of powerlessness, that all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, and Jesus is the manifestation of God's plan of salvation. He is Jesus's God. Jesus is God's plan of salvation in your life and all the people of the earth. And whether you realize it or not, you are in recovery. You are in recovery from sin and brokenness. How do you plug into that power? You plug in by making Jesus the Lord of your life. The kingdom is present in Him. You get on your knees and you come to that place of poverty of spirit and you say, Lord, I need you. Jesus, I got a mess in my life and only you can clean it up. Lord, I got some brokenness in my soul and I know that only you can heal it. And you know, doctors and physicians and medication, those are good things. But only Jesus can cure your soul. Amen. Only Jesus can redeem you. Only the power that is in Jesus can clean up the messiness of your life. Do you see, folks, why we need a program like Celebrate Recovery in our church? Because it takes us through this simple process, what Leslie called the order of salvation. It takes us through that process and it gives us a safe place where we can come and say, Jesus, I'm not okay. I've got problems in my life. I've got brokenness in my life. Whether you're Christian for 60, 70, 80 years, you've got some brokenness in your life. And it gives us a place where we can come and be authentic and be real and take off our masks and say, we're all in recovery together. We've all got hurts, habits, and hang-ups, and we need the Lord to heal those things. See, we are God's extension cords. And He wants to heal us. He wants to give you the power to transform your life. But But not just for you. Because when you're plugged into the right power source, He wants to convey His energy and His eternal life out into that messy, broken world. And there's a lot of work to do out there. But Jesus rolls up His sleeves and He joins us in that effort of recovery. And we as the church are called to go out with the tools that He has given us and the instruction manual that He has provided. And to labor and to work, to bring healing where there's brokenness. To bring wholeness where there's fractured relationship. To bring the cure where there is pain and sin. Where do you turn when you're broken? Where do you go when you're hurting? You come to the one and the only one that can heal you. We come to our Savior, our Lord, Jesus Christ. And every week after week, we come to this table. This is the table that manifests God's desire to recover the human race. This is the table where week after week, we do those first couple principles, those first couple steps. We come in a state of poverty of spirit. We come acknowledging our deep need for God. We come to this table also with a mourning heart. As we mourn the fact that once again we have sinned and fallen short of the glory. We mourn the state of the world where there are people out there that don't know Christ. And we mourn most of all the sacrifice of our sin. The broken body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And it's at this table where we partake of this grape juice and this bread. Bread and grape juice that are shot through with the life of heaven and the power of the kingdom. It's at this place where we come, maybe for the first time, and say, Jesus, I need you. Jesus, I'm broken. Jesus, I want you to be the Lord of my life. It's at this table where we come week after week and say, Jesus, I've been walking with you, but I've got some things in my soul I need you to cure. It's at this table where we come together to the only one who can cure us. The Lord be with you. Amen.